You're listening to Grant's Rants. Subscribe and spread the word.
There are a lot more rants to come.
Listen anytime on all major podcasting platforms. And now, back to the show.
And we're back on the podcast. I'm joined by my friend Chloe Rhys. Welcome back.
Hi, everybody. Hi, Grant.
Are you ready to talk about Britney? There's a lot to say.
I am. Absolutely.
We're in the free Britney era, post era. And wow, there's still a lot developing and happening because Britney finally has her damn voice to be able to say what she wants to say. And the notes app is burning up.
Yeah, it's interesting. We haven't chatted on the pod since Britney got a partial freedom. And yeah, so that's awesome to check in and all the, well, the many happenings this week around Britney and the Spears family.
Let's start with Jamie Lynn Spears. She put out a book. There's been nothing but horrible press around it. No one asked for this book. Nobody cares about this book. And it just makes me question why. Why is she putting out a book talking about her sister? What is the point of this? And what is the timing around this? Britney has been trending worldwide, not Jamie Lynn. So it only tells me that someone is riding the wave of popularity and in a big way. Why? Who would give Jamie Lynn a publishing deal? Like, I just don't, like, she has, like, for what?
Well, like she's Britney's sister. So probably in with the idea that she might have something interesting to say about her sister, probably isn't about, you know, finding out the philosophy of Jamie Lynn's life or, you know, learning more about her.
The original title of the book was I Must Confess, which is a take on Britney's lyrics and Baby One More Time. So like the whole thing is really ugly to me, the timing. And I believe that Lou Taylor has some type of a partnership with GMA. GMA, we saw Britney had circus stuff there. Daddy loves her. The attorneys were running to GMA to do media matters. Now they have this GMA interview with Jamie Lynn. And that was Lou Taylor's house, right? Did you catch that?
Yeah, I saw that on social media.
Interview is held at Lou Taylor's house, not even Jamie Lynn's house. So it shows how like tight they are.
They are very tight from, it appears.
Well, she's still her manager too. Now, to me, this was the wrong platform. I think maybe if Jamie Lynn went over to the gutter called The View and did an interview over there, that would be more appropriate. But an exclusive GMA and Nightline sit down, like, it's just, this doesn't warrant that in my point of view. Like, who's the audience for this book? And like, they're doing this interview, it's basically 80% about Britney and it's not even with Britney. So why is this an ABC News exclusive? This seems like the wrong place for this.
Yeah, I have the same questions you do, Grant. Honestly, I can't imagine that maybe the 10,000 still existing fans of Zoe One-on-One were enough to warrant a book about Jamie Lynn that doesn't speak about Britney. I don't know who Jamie Lynn's, who might be a fan of Jamie Lynn who is not a fan of Britney. That must be a very small audience.
Well, I want to get your take on the interview. My take is I saw someone with no empathy, someone who played the victim card as often as possible. And while they were not doing that in between, they were playing ignorant. They were playing the ignorant card that they were either too young or too busy or too pregnant to understand for the last 13 years that they were, in my point of view, enabling abuse. I can't put it any other way. This is my take. This is my opinion, but at no point, like we educated ourselves. I've talked about it for many, many months on this podcast. I don't claim to know all the facts, but I know what a conservatorship is and what conservatorship abuse is. So at no point did this woman say that she maybe was a little curious what the dynamic was. She knew enough though to sign the paperwork, though, to inherit the estate should Britney pass. She knew enough what that was all about, though. Despite lying in the interview saying she had nothing to gain from this, Go ahead. Sorry, I could go off. Go ahead.
Oh no, I think, you know, you can't play smart and stupid at the same time, which is what she's doing here. And, you know, it does. I believe in the interview, she claimed that she didn't know what a conservatorship was, but she was pregnant. And then today she knows as much or as little as at the time, which, you know, it's just like, okay, you didn't want to take the time to maybe look, you know, when this is all over the media everywhere, to maybe just understand what a conservatorship was. And then I think she also addressed the fact that she was a signee or a name on the financial aspect of the conservatorship, or mentioned that that was a misunderstanding, but the it was worded very strangely. Like it was a misunderstanding or might have been, but you know, her name is on it. So, you know, whether she knew, or I would assume you would know if your name is on a trust that represents a lot of money. So
my takeaway from this interview was that she's either straight up lying, like with no concern for the truth, or that she has been twisted by, again, my opinion, Lou Taylor or her father. I think someone's in her ear, because she's claiming to be very ignorant about the stuff that, like, we know what's going on. Like we're for the most part, and we're not even like within communication to Britney. So it's just, there were a lot of inconsistencies on both parts, and I'm going to get into that. But like, to me, I think she really does believe what she's selling. And it seems really like off to me. You have to watch the interview if you haven't already. Again, yes, I'm a blind Britney supporter, but I want to get into that a little bit more. But at the same time, like, this interview was just such a bad look. Everything she's been putting out there, all the press, everything she's putting on social media, it's just burying her. I don't see how anyone could be sympathetic to Jamie Lynn.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I'm a lifelong Britney fan, so I'll always be Team Brit. And, you know, I've always found Jamie Lynn's social media presence to be unbearable, and just her whole brand unbearable. So I'm not really going into this with a ton of sympathy for Jamie Lynn. You know, I've always hated her, just like, yeah, her filters, her just trying so hard.
Trying very, very, and, very, you know, very
I guess
hard.
It was just really hard during the whole very big Free Britney movement to watch her just going along with life, posting her promoting her various quote unquote projects and children, and you know, just going along as life was normal. That just felt like such a bad, tasteless look. And, you know, so going into this with not a lot of sympathy for her. However, you know, I don't condone bullying, and I don't think, you know, I've many times wanted to post nasty comments on her Instagram, but you know, I didn't. I don't think that's a good vibe either. But you know, it's interesting. I try and think about what would I do if I was the sibling of someone extremely famous and amazingly talented, and just happened to be their little sister. It's not
show your
position.
Loyalty.
Yeah.
I show mean, your loyalty. I mean, that's what I would do. And that's why I think she has different people in her ear telling her things, because what sibling would behave that way? And Britney's basically calling it out in all of these posts. Yeah. Like, this is supposed to be her family. And like, her and her brother were laughing at Britney at the gate or something. Again, we don't know, but this is what Britney wrote. It's like, I think that she's got people in her ear that are financially motivated to keep her kind of in this ambiguous place where if this were me, there's nobody telling me anything about like family members. Like, I'm a facts person. So I don't really respect it either. Again, you can't be ignorant and smart at the same time. It's so well said. Yeah. So let's talk a little bit more about what I want to say here. The notes apps. This has been a lot of back and forth. Britney called Jamie Lynn scum after being accused of being irate with a knife. And she, you know, Jamie Lynn went on to say that she was scared and fearful about Britney. These are all points that she knew she was going to get pressed for. It's ugly. The whole thing is gross, back and forth. Look, I don't know what the truth is. And Britney could be embellishing. Jamie Lynn is, let's just say she could be embellishing, but somewhere in the middle is the truth. And it's really an ugly dynamic of this is playing out the way that it is. And I feel like if half of what Britney said was an embellishment or a lie, it's still the truth part of it is still super, super controversial and bad. So I have no sympathy for Jamie Lynn. I can't even see her side in this. She wasn't there for her sister. She was an enabler, in my opinion. She will always be the little sister. She's sitting there in Lou Taylor's house giving an interview. If that doesn't show you who she's loyal to, I don't know what does. She'll always be a little sister. In my opinion, she's a bully and enabler. Grant's rants.
Yeah, I love that you say the things that I'm thinking, but haven't said out loud. This was an interesting saga to follow between, you know, Britney's response to Jamie Lynn's response to Britney's response to Jamie Lynn's interview. So it was a lot of notes apps and a lot of things that I don't, you know, I feel icky, honestly, reading just because it is so personal and it's just sad, you know, to see a family that is going through things like this. You know, everything has been kind of in the public forum forever. And, you know, even these kinds of, personal relationships as well. I couldn't stand Jamie Lynn's response where I hate to burst my sister's bubble, but my book isn't about her. Like, really, again, with, you know, I must confess
don't write salacious stories in the book. Don't write salacious stories. Then if you're going to sit down and do an interview, then you say, look, I am so happy that my sister has been emancipated, basically. I wish her nothing but the best and health and happiness. And I want to keep my relationship with her out of the press. It's very important to me that, you know, we have our own relationship independent from the public eye. I, you know, love to talk about my book, but I really have nothing to speak of to my sister right now about. So that should have been it. Instead, with the telling tales, bringing the kids into it. Come on. Even what's her face? Britney even was like, come on, Jamie Lynn, come on. You know, it's a lot. It's a lot. And it's a really bad look. I can't think of a book that had worse press around it. Can you?
But, you know, if you look at Jamie Lynn's Instagram, apparently the book is, in some top 25 lists or some people are pre-ordering it. So on her end, she's
not hard to do these days. I think they say you only have to sell a couple thousand books to get on that bestseller list. So the New York Times bestseller. So
wow.
Let's see. Definitely for me, like I'm going out of my way obviously I'm not going to buy the book, but I wanted to watch her GMA interview, but like not on the official ABC news channel. I just don't want to give the numbers and the data or whatever it is to support that. I just don't think it's appropriate to give her a voice and not Britney. And I know they reached out to Britney, but come on. The biggest thing I got out of all these exchanges, and they were, I don't want to say they were juicy because it was actually kind of sad, but the biggest thing I got out of it was Britney says she wishes she would be able to do interviews, saying that she's scared of it all. Who could blame her? And, you know, here's once again, as Britney said, another family member doing a book in an interview, profiting off of her. And she's too afraid to even, I don't know, sit down with Oprah. I don't know. It's a shame because she doesn't know who to trust.
Yeah.
So that was eye-opening because I've said this and I still want to hear from her and I want to hear her story. I she doesn't owe me anything, but I think that the movement and everything, I think she could give a little something. But yeah, she's still scared.
And, you know, what about Brian? I guess I have a big question mark for me is, you know, Brian is Britney's brother. Assuming he wasn't there for her either, but I guess, yeah, he's not probably, Britney's not as triggered by him not helping by the fact that he's not, you know, going, writing books about it and going public with his story. But, you know, I guess, yeah, there is a question mark there for me. It's like, how come Brian gets a pass, I guess? No, we don't hear about it.
She's had a lot to say about her family. And so I'd like to think that she means all of them in her posts. And so now there's like a lot of photos that she's posting of her bare behind, some topless photos with the little hearts on them. And, you know, I can defend this myself. Yes, it's kooky and strange. It is. It's Britney, bitch. Like, it's just, I don't know what to say. That's Britney. But at the same time, like, she's regaining her body from her father. She is finding her own sexuality again. She's owning her body for the first time in 13 years. And there's got to be an element of this just horrifying her family and her just being like, this is the middle finger to you guys. Here it is. So I think she's, while it's upsetting to see the back and forth, I think she's kind of feeling empowered. I think she's being empowered with calling Jamie out publicly on Twitter, a little bit on Instagram, which I cannot figure out why she's favoring Twitter these days. It's such a mystery, but I think it's a little bit of an F you.
Yeah, I don't think it's too deep. I really just think Britney's the type of person who's like, woke up, I felt cute today. And, you know, I lost 3 pounds maybe, and I'm feeling really, you know, hot in my body. So I'm going to post this. And
she looks great.
Yeah, she looks amazing. And, you know, again, I think she's just, I think she's just like, she just posts what she wants and does, you know, how she feels today. And that she's a very sexual person. And, and that's good on her, you know.
It's no different from any other porn star, bodybuilder, adult person on Instagram flexing for the gram. Like, yeah, I mean, now this is her time to be able to be like, here's what I want to put out in the world, where her image was so protected and strangely like engineered that now she's like, yeah, I woke up, I feel hot, I lost like some weight. I love this picture of my ass. Here it is. Kiss it.
I think it's like people are probably shocked because, you know, the way she posts, she isn't, you know, filtering it through 100 filters, or, you know, it's not an extremely curated photo that she's done on a bed with, you know, it's not like an Erika Jayne style sexy pic, right? It's because it's with a dirty, like a old iPhone camera that she set up on her, you know, tripod stand in her bathroom with all her stuff on her counter. So I think it's that we're used to seeing celebrities, you know, be very sexual, but from a very, you know, safe and curated aesthetic way. And it's just that her very, you know, not polished Instagram posts maybe are a little more like, ooh, this feels very intimate.
True. Yeah, I mean, there's some full frontal nudity. I mean, what can you say? But, you know, I just want to hear from her and set the record straight. And if she disappears, she is more than entitled to do so. But she's still teasing this Instagram stuff. She's still in our faces every day. And it's like, what is going on? It, to me, it's just endlessly fascinating.
I loved when she sang to us a couple of weeks ago. That was really the highlight. I loved hearing her voice.
I liked the therapist skit, whatever that was.
Oh, that too. That was amazing. I loved the therapist skit.
She's wacky. And wouldn't you be if your father owned you for 13 years? So just saying.
Yeah. I mean, if your father owned you for 13 years and you were taken out of school to be on the Mickey Mouse Club and then subsequently worked for 20 years without stopping and, you know, we're never around peers. There's a lot that probably would shape the person that you are as an adult that Britney went through.
I say it again. I agree. Let's transition to The View. I don't know how to get out of that and into The View. They're back in virtual production, which I hate. Everyone in squares again. I can't stand it. You don't strike me as a viewer of The View. You don't watch every day.
I used to watch at one point when Elizabeth Hasselbeck was on the show. Oh, and here's a golden fun fact days. A fun fact about me is I tried out to be on The View in France as a host. Many years ago, I lived in France. I grew up in France and I worked in journalism there. And, at one point they were adapting the show for France and I made it through maybe 3, cycles of auditions.
Yeah. Wow. I did not know this,
but that's my connection to The View. Otherwise, yeah, I hear about, the hairstyles, the, you know, the eating on camera, various, and mostly through your through your social media. So you're my big view, well, hater, I guess.
Yeah, definitely a hater since the mid-90s when it began. I mean, there's just something about the show. I've actually peeled back like a little bit of step back, I should say, from how much I've had to watch it, because it's just, it goes beyond hate watching into like, I just don't even want to hear a voice from that show. So like, I really have had to stop. The virtual stuff does not help. But to me, I wrote down that the show is continuously unwatchable garbage. Oh God, I really do not hold back with the show. But the New York Post says that The View has been in talks with a conservative podcast host, Liz Wheeler, Meghan McCain's top choice. Now, why is Meghan McCain still weighing in? I guess she submitted names. This was on a list, but I've never heard of Liz Wheeler. I don't consume cable news at all. Liz is 32. She used to be a host of OAN, One American News Network, which I hate to even promote. I think they're just the absolute lowest of the low. So it makes sense that she'd try out for The View. And it sounds like another Elizabeth Hasselbeck bot, right? Her name is Liz. Mm-hmm. She's there to promote the other side in any way she can. I don't know if I see this ending well, if this should go through with Liz Wheeler. How does it sound to you?
Well, I'm looking at pictures of her. She looks like the type of person I would assume is a right-wing commenter. I'm surprised that she's 32. but yeah, I mean, yeah, I guess, I see also that Ebony was hosting at some point. That kind of seemed a little bit more interesting to me, just to have someone who might be not your traditional representation of the right or red side might be.
Right.
But if that was where Ebony K. Williams was sitting, but I don't know. This girl just looks like any random Trump person. Sorry.
When it comes to Ebony, I think she would be the best choice for this because, hear me out, because she would come in prepared and actually take this job very seriously. Mm-hmm. Where everybody else, they all have their own producers that prep them and they read off of note cards, like someone who hosts a late night show on Bravo. So it's like very similar in that sense. So I like that Ebony would actually like come to the table. She would have a view. I might not agree with it, but she would have a polished and prepared view. I don't know anything about Liz Wheeler. I don't know anything about her. Then in this article, this is over on page 6, this random line they dropped in between all this information about Liz, they said, the dream host is Condoleezza Rice. Now, I have a lot to say about this, but I don't know why. To me, it's just like, she's just represents an older voice. She represents the neocons. She's like, she's from the Bush era. Like, why is she the dream?
That's a good question. It seems like a very strange choice. And I mean, I don't really think of her as being a TV personality. Has she hosted talk shows or?
They did put her in earlier in the season on The View, I believe. She spoke about the passing of Colin Powell. Yes, she.
I mean, she's a legit person.
She is.
Yeah.
She's legit, but too legit for The View.
Yes.
I mean, you know, they talk about like January 6th, then they go and talk about, you know, men's underwear and stuff like that. I mean, it's just like, don't waste your time. And I also would love to hear from a younger voice. And I just think that she represents like a different kind of Republican that is just not going to, it's just not going to be the voice of where the Republicans are today. I don't know. I don't even know if we need to hear from that voice, but maybe we do because it is a news program because they put it under the news umbrella. Now with this girl, Liz, I say test her out. I don't think they're going to do so because they said that she is unvaccinated. So that's, you know, a nail in her coffin. But now that they're doing this virtually, throw her in, call her up. Anyway, I think that it's a mess over there. The executive producer, Brian Tatta, who I have absolutely very little respect for, is labeled as a people pleaser. And they said the panel runs right over him. So that means that whoever is going to be filling this chair, Joy and Whoopi are casting. Let's just be real. So I don't think Liz stands a chance. I think this was just a clickbait article now that I'm really reflecting on it with you. But I know, and they said that she's been in talks with The View since September. But if she's unvaccinated and the policy is they must be vaccinated, I know that is the policy at ABC. It's not even worth having a discussion then. She's not going to get vaccinated to do that show.
Ooh, I mean, maybe.
She should.
Yeah.
Will she? I don't know. Chloe, thanks for coming on. This was a good time.
Oh, it's been amazing. Thanks, Grant.
Well, we'll have to continue to follow what's going on Britney's Instagram. I mean, at any point.
Absolutely. Yeah, I don't doubt there won't be more things to cover in the future.
Oh, my God. Between the Twitter now and the Instagram, when something comes up, I literally stop everything that I'm doing. Everything goes on mute. And I'm like, okay, what is this now? It's a lot. It's like being on call.
100%. Yeah.
All right. Well, great to have you on. Love to see you.
Amazing. Always great to talk to you, Grant. Have an amazing week.
Thank you. You too. And you guys too. Thanks for so much for listening. I know that the shows are far and few between these days. I'm launching a new show for HBO. It's called The Gilded Age, or should I say The Official Gilded Age Podcast. And there's a little wink at the top, but I am excited for you guys to hear it. I'm producing it, and I just want to shout it out. It's a good watch, so check it out. But that's been taking up all my time, so I'm glad to have this time with you now on Grant's Rants. And as always, we'll be back with more rants. My thanks to Chloe. See you soon.
This has been Grant's Rants. Follow Grant on Twitter and Instagram at It's Grant's Rants. Cover art created by Howie Roneg. Original theme music by Alexander Artson. The Grant Michael Collection.